is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead, we are one with him again. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Oh, death, where is your sting?
Good evening, everybody. I'll wait a little bit longer. Yeah. Good evening, everybody. Amen. Glad to see you all here tonight for the special service as our college students are going to report on their mission trip to Syracuse. And so I'm just going to pray and get out of the way and let them do it. So let us pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for these who have gone on this trip. Lord, we ask your blessings on this time that we may be inspired to do the work of your kingdom across this country and across the world. Just ask your blessings on them as they come to present now and share the great things that they've done for you and your kingdom in Syracuse. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Good evening. I was low man on the totem pole, so I guess I get to introduce us. We obviously went to Syracuse, New York, on our spots trip. What does spots stand for?
Special
projects other than summer. That's it. I can never remember. So, and obviously, you guys know that since y'all funded us. So, and just thank you for that, because we couldn't have done it without you, and we would have most definitely missed out on a blessing had it not been for y'all. So thank you so much. We're just going to kind of do things as each day, each one of us is going to talk about a day, and then we'll just kind of go from there. We got some pictures going on and maybe a few videos. So we'll just get started that way and then take it from there.
Okay, so they all got to pick what they want, so I got the scraps. And No. I liked the trip a lot. It was a very special experience. Definitely, to start out, it is a totally different world up there. They don't smile. They go to school for school. And Christians aren't the majority. And so, going up there, Brian, would you mind doing this?
Yeah.
There we go. See, we're very happy right here. Gretchen's asleep, I'm waking up, Brian's in shock, and Michelle's looking at the car about to crash into us. No, nothing happened. But it was a very long journey. We headed out on Friday evening due to some postponements. We didn't get to leave till about 7 o'clock. And we drove to the Tennessee-Virginia line. So, first thing I do on that lovely bus is I lay my head down on the seat in front of me and go to sleep for about 2.5 hours. And we get off at the hotel, I'm like, man, my head hurts. And I was like, nah, I've just been bouncing around this whole time. I had gotten carpet burn on my forehead from the seat in front of me. And so the entire trip, people thought I had a birthmark on my forehead. And I was like, nope, it's healing. By the end, it kind of left me. But if you continue here, sir. The second day, we continued on. And Brother Jeff Redman, he is a preacher out of Huntsville, actually in Hartsville, and is one of the girls that went with us. He is her father, and so he chaperoned us along with Brian. And we had good and bad. But he loves history, and as does Michelle and a couple of others on the trip, and so we decided to go to Gettysburg. It went through the exit, why not go, you know? And so that was a very cool experience. We were like, cool, we get to see the battlefield, get to go through all this stuff. Not quite. It costs about $15 for a burger. Takes about 3 hours to go through one of the tours and paying out more money. So we ended up just jerry-rigging the system and doing it on our own. And if you would continue, that's the statue. I wanted to kind of be funny and make different poses around Abe Lincoln, but it was very cool to go to this place that has so much history with the North and the South. I guess in the reenactments, the South does not win, unfortunately. But that's actually Devil's Gulch, Devil's Den. Basically, it's a bunch of rocks where everybody got killed. The Confederates got a hold of it, and they were hiding in the crevices, and basically they got closed in and wiped out for the most part. But we got to climb on them like big little kids, which was a lot of fun. There's Michelle right there, if you continue, dear sir. And there is good old Abe. You know, you kind of take for granted what we have and just the government that we live in, and just actually going and again to go to the site of where he gave his speech was emancipation was very, very neat and very humbling. And so that was a nice little side note that we went to. We continue. Yeah, there they are, having fun. And so we arrive at Syracuse, and there is snow. This white powdery stuff that doesn't visit here. A fantastic amount. By the time we took this picture, it all melted, but it was clogging up the place. So the first thing we do when we get off the bus is a snowball fight. The girls got tired of it real quick by the fourth day. But, I mean, we didn't. And it was fantastic. The thing about where we went is you have Syracuse University, which was, it's been around for a while, it's one of the first universities to accept Jewish students. And so they are about 40% Jewish. And their chaplain there is a chaplain's office. It's kind of military orientated from what I'm used to. We have the BCM with the Baptist campus minister there. And then you also have across the room the pagan chaplain, the Lutheran chaplain, the Muslim chaplain. What was the other one? The rabbi had his own building, as did the Catholics. But it was very interesting to get to interact with these people, because here everybody kind of sticks around who you're used to. I have a lot of Christian friends, and so going up there, they actually have a lot of non-Christian friends. I mean, you have to interact with them. And also, at Syracuse, hey, I got louder, they have a brother school, which is ESF, My Salvation, while I was up there. Man, I was going up there expecting a bunch of snotty-nosed northerners, as we all think of them as. And, hey, look at that. No offense. Okay, I take it back. Not all of us think this. But ESF stands for Environmental Science Forestry College. This is where all the rednecks go to school. And so, we got to live with lumberjacks. I was amazed. I meet the guy that I'm living with, and he's wearing a Carhartt, a camo hat. I was in heaven. And we really just got to interact with them. That evening, we had a mixer, went to a New York pizza joint, lots of good pizza, and really just got to have the beginnings of those relationships begin to build. And the cool thing was is that we actually got to stay with college students. They opened up their homes to us, and so we got to know them in a totally different way than you might normally do on a mission trip, with just that daily interaction, and then you go home to your own little clique, when we went home, we were with them. And so it was very, very neat to get to know these people. That's actually the campus. That is Hogwarts right there. And you can't see it to the left, but like their bib graves is the model of the Addams Family House. I mean, this place was wicked cool. It the architecture there was from the oldest to the newest. None of them looked alike, and it was very diverse, very liberal in everything. And so we kind of had to readjust. And so our camera people didn't take their cameras the day I'm talking about, but the 2 days I'm talking about. But Sunday we went to campus church, and they have their own little thing where they come to worship on campus, since churches are kind of little isolated islands in this territory up there. And so it was very different, because here we plug into churches. I mean, there's a church around the corner wherever you go, and here not so much. I mean, we're talking to people, the only Baptist church in the town, they had never seen anybody open up the door. And so it was student-led. Had a younger chaplain that's actually taking over the BCM role in this up-and-coming year. And we got to worship with them, which was very neat. We got to see some of the similarities we have and some of the differences. And then we went to go eat Chinese, fellowship over food. I mean, we're bringing the South up there if we have to. And we just basically went on a tour, walking around campus, and got to rest in preparation of the next day. That's when the work began. And the day I'm talking about is Lemoyne College Day. And Lemoyne College is a Catholic college. It's about 3 miles away. It has upteen laws about talking to people about any other denomination or any other set belief outside of what they teach. And so it's very restricted there. What's very neat is one of the Syracuse students was a semester missionary and got plugged in there. And got to build a club. It's called the 220 Club, based off of Galatians 2:20. And it wasn't just Baptist, it wasn't just Catholic, it was outreaching to all people. What you have to understand is that while it's harder to interact with other religions and denominations here, up there, I mean, that girl right there, the one in the white t-shirt, tan skin next to the Sudan, Nilo and Nibang, and Nilo, I got to interact with her, and I was like, so how long have you known Christ? She's like, I'm actually Muslim. I was like, whoa, okay, tell me more. They're very open, because their good deeds up there are done more in a social work standard of doing your good deed of the year for your job. I got to interact with some students here, even though we weren't supposed to. And they actually went on a trip to Africa to bring nursing to third world countries. And I was like, wow, that's fantastic. What ministry did you go with? We didn't. This is part of our job. So they have a very different perspective of what we might have. And I had to step out of my conservative, I'm going to be comfortable mode, and readjust to being open to these people. This is a ministry that we really aren't open to it at Jacksonville. And it was a unique chance to interact with these people, to share Christ, to hear their stories, and just to live with one another. And within that 220 Club, we built some relationships. And I got a couple guys' phone numbers, and I was like, I'm going to call and harass you with some of my personal struggles. But they built homeless meals. And they all did that together. I got to meet a girl from Tennessee, and she was like, whoa. And I can't tell you how amazing it was to just see the Spirit moving in these small little interactions, to being open to deist, Catholicist, Jewish. That 220 Club was based off of prayer. That guy I was telling you about, he actually just went there and started praying over the campus, and two other people joined him. And they finally got the board to accept their club. And the board was kind of hesitant. It was a real close choice. And this past year, they got to go on a mission trip, in which, because of their involvement over the past year, the club paid, the school paid for most of it. They provided a van, a chaperone, paid for most of the expenses, and are supportive to their ministry now. So to just see people so intentional about prayer with these interactions and with this ministry was a very, very special experience. But Gretchen's going to tell you about Tuesday.
Hi, I'm Gretchen Glass, and if you don't know me, I'm sorry I haven't met you yet. I've been coming to Williams since I've been at Jacksonville, and I'm really glad that I've gotten to know you guys, and I'm really excited to say that I'm graduating in 5 days. So I just wanted to tell you guys thank you so much for letting me be a part of your church while I was here. But the trip on Tuesday, that's what I'm going to talk about. We stayed with college students from Syracuse, and this is a picture of the two girls that I stayed with. And we had to be up at the BCM at 8 o'clock. And down there, people don't drive around. You walk everywhere. So they lived probably 3 or 4 blocks away. So we walked, and we met up at the office. You can go ahead and change it. Thank you. And this is kind of what the office looked like. We met up there to make things called random acts of kindness. And we made little postcards that had granola bars on them with the BCM's name, so people would just know more about it. Because one of the problems that they were having at Syracuse is that people just didn't know about it. So that's what we were trying to do, was just spread the word. So we just would go out on the sidewalk, pass them out, and people aren't as open as they are here, so even though it had food on it, they still wouldn't take it. So, but some people would, and we were able to talk to some of them. I got to meet some people on the rowing team, some people on the basketball team, so that was neat. We also did prayer walking around the campus, and I really liked that we were doing, like, meaningful prayer walks. We had a list of what to pray for like, each building. Then we had lunch at the BCM that day, too, and all the BCMers there that were involved really tried to make a point, even though they had classes and they had their own life, they tried to make a point to come and, you know, encourage us and support us. So they came and ate with us that day. Then we did something kind of fun. We had a scavenger hunt, and it helped us get to know the campus a little better. And then we also had, like, serious things that we did. But the first thing that we had to do was we had to take a picture on the quad with our shoes off, and it was really cold. And this is at the ESF building, which is like all the biology people, and they didn't want you to walk on their grass, so this was a big deal. Apparently, if you step on the grass, someone will come from nowhere and tackle you. So so we got that picture, thankfully. Then we had to take a picture with the statue of Job, and we're acting like Job there. Then we had to get a picture with the bear, just things like that for the funny part. For the serious part, once we started reading these, we saw, you know, share your faith with 3 people. Then it stopped being more of a race, because we were like, well, we don't want to just, you know, race through this. It was more of like a challenge. So we had to meet 3 different people from a different country or state or something like that. And I remember I met someone from Australia, China, and I can't remember. Where'd y'all meet people from? Puerto Rico. Okay. Then we also had to pray with 3 different people, and that was harder than it sounds, because people were not open to that. So I think we got turned down 5 out of the 8 times that we got to pray with someone. So But hey, we got to pray with three people. Then we had to share our faith in a meaningful way with at least three people. And the way that we did that was, I don't know if this is right or not, but one of the funny things was to ride the bus. So we got on the bus, and we got people, I guess, where they couldn't leave, you know, because they're on a bus. So we had three people on our team, so we just spaced out in the bus. And whoever sat down next to us, that's who we were talking to. So I kind of got shut down the first time. And so I just moved on and talked to somebody different. But we were all able to talk to someone. I think the bus ride was like 15 minutes. And so just having things like that, that really taught me to actually use everything you have in life to, you know, talk to people. Like, I'm going to be a teacher. I can encourage my coworkers, or I can encourage encourage a student or something like that. And just sharing your faith on a bus, that's something you can do every day. What's the next picture? Okay. In the afternoon, we kind of had the day off, and the big thing there was to climb trees in a cemetery. So that's what they were doing there. I think Alex tried it. Didn't go so well. we just kind of got to hang around the campus and meet people, because like we slept at these people's houses at night, but we were pretty much on campus all day because, you know, we didn't want to be at their house when they weren't there. So that kind of set us up for just, you know, sitting around campus talking to people. Also, during our break, we planned for worship because we were going to lead worship that night at Syracuse. So at worship that night, we had our creative ministries team perform. We had, I think we had four people perform for the creative ministries, and they had never seen anything like that, so they thought it was really neat. And then we had a girl give her testimony, and it was really powerful. She was a great speaker. And then our chaperone, Brother Edmund, gave a short devotion. And then after that, oh, these are some of the people that are involved in the BCM up there. So. Okay. After that, apparently the big thing in Syracuse is called bubble tea. Has anybody ever heard of that? Okay, I had never heard of it. It's like tea with little tapioca bubbles in it, and they pop in your mouth. So, I don't know. It wasn't sweet tea, but it was good. So, that's a picture of it. All those little black things in the bottom are little bitty tapioca bubbles. So, but anyways, that's just what Tuesday looked like. Who's next?
I'm Brian. So, hey, if I haven't met y'all before. So I'll talk about Wednesday. So the first 2 days on Monday and Wednesday had to deal more with Syracuse, the actual university and all. Whereas Wednesday, we kind of branched away from the university and looked at some other ministries and helped out with some other ministries that kind of go along with that are going on in the rest of the town of Syracuse. there's this ministry, they call themselves the Hope Print House, three words. And basically, just to kind of give you a background, I know this is really surprising, it was to me, Syracuse has a very large refugee population. I would say between 10 and 20,000 people as far as refugees, really from all over the world. Most of the people that we met were refugees from Africa, really all over Africa, the Middle East, and also South Asia. And so that was interesting for the first thought there. But basically, there's this group of Christians who've kind of banded together and made this organization called the Hope Print House. They really were inspired to help these refugees who, most of them, they come over here because they feel like America can give them the best chance at life, give their families the best chance at life as far as, you know, making a little money and surviving. Whereas in their home country, they may have been pushed out because of politics or because of culture or faith. And so they pretty much are homeless, and America has just kind of taken them in. And because of that, a lot of these people, they don't know how to speak English. They don't have a job because they don't know how to speak English, so they don't have a way of income. So this is, you know, a lot of these people live in poverty. They may have a house, but it's not much of a house. And so we've got a large refugee population up there from really Africa, the Middle East, South Asia, places like that. And this group of Christians kind of really had a yearning to reach out to these people and try to help them somehow, even if it was with basic needs. And so they started going out into these communities, I mean, of refugees where they would try to, you know, go and become friends with them first, obviously, and try to teach them English, try to get them, once they got past that point, they could try to help them get a job, take care of their kids while they were out doing things. And it really was kind of starting to become a booming ministry. And because of that, the city of Syracuse saw their works and saw that, you know, the good stuff that they were doing. Now, first of all, they don't really necessarily advertise themselves as a Christian organization. It's more or less an organization that goes out towards the refugee, to the refugee communities to try to help them. But the city of Syracuse recognized their deeds and their good works for these people, and actually donated a house that had been abandoned to them in the middle of this refugee neighborhood. And so they have this nice home that they fixed up and everything, and they call it the Hope Print House. And they've converted this house pretty much into like a community center for all these refugees, kind of in the midst of their where they live and their neighborhoods and everything. And this is where they have, you know, English classes and childcare and things like that. And like I said, they help them try to get a job once they've learned English and all that kind of stuff. So basically with that background, they needed some spring cleaning. And so on Wednesday, we woke up early and drove out to this area for the refugee population and pretty much did some deep spring cleaning for these people. we shoveled snow that was still left behind. We dusted, vacuumed, did a little bit of painting, rearranged furniture, all that kind of, I mean, anything and everything. We went from top to bottom in this house to make it look good. And so that, because they have, you know, people coming in and out of this house every day. I mean, like I said, it's like a community center. So, on top of that, there's a house that's right next door to this house. It's kind of the community center, and the city's actually looking to maybe donate this other house next to them, donate to this Hope Print house organization. And basically what they want to do, see, all these houses these are pictures of all of us working and everything like that. Basically all these houses are kind of built really close together, and so there's no, you know, green grass anywhere or playgrounds or anything for these kids to play on. So what they want to do, if this goes through where the city donates the second house, they want to bulldoze it and make it kind of like a playground for all the kids to play. So that's pretty cool. Anyway, we did a lot. We basically did some deep spring cleaning for these people, and worked all day there. Did everything we could, and then later that night, this kind of goes out to them as far as, you know, how much they do for their neighbors and everything like that in this neighborhood. They had we were invited to come back to the Hope Print House for a kind of a potluck dinner. And they had anybody and everyone in the neighborhood who wanted to come and bring a dish, potluck dinner, and just converse with one another and get to know each other. And we got to come and try some new foods and some spicy ones at that. And here's some pictures of all of us talking. And really, in all actuality, it's a good thing for these refugees because they get to talk to other Americans that they don't necessarily have access to all the time, and they get to develop their English a little better and try to understand what we're saying, especially with that southern dialect twang in there. That probably makes it a little more interesting. We really got to know these people and build relationships with them, and that's what this whole ministry is all about. You know, like I said, they don't necessarily advertise themselves as a Christian organization, but that's the foundation of their organization. They build relationships with these people, and eventually, you know, they become friends with them, and eventually are able to share Christ with them. Whether they accept it or not, you know, obviously that's their decision, but they get to, you know, introduce Jesus to them, whereas they may not have been able to in the past. So that's Wednesday, so I'll pass it on to Michelle for Thursday.
My name is Michelle. I don't think I know any of you, so. I had Thursday. This has nothing to do with Thursday, but I wore my cowboy boots today for a reason. One of the girls that actually Gretchen stayed with, her name was Shelby. I wore my cowboy boots one day, and she said, "Are those real?" I was like, "Real." I said, "Real what?" She said, "Is that real? Are those real cowboy boots?" I was like, "Well, yeah." She said, "I've never seen one before." I was like, "Say what?" So I was thinking, I mean, you throw a penny, and I'm pretty sure just about everybody in this room owns a pair of cowboy boots. She had never seen a real leather cowboy boot. So I told her, I said, "Someday, somehow, I'm gonna send you a pair of cowboy boots you can wear in New York and say that you finally own a pair." So, but that has nothing to do with anything. That was just a side note that I thought about. I had the fourth day, Thursday, and we got to talk to a guy. His name was Pastor Beam. Pastor Beam, I'll tell you his little background story, because when we got there, it's in a very sketchy part of the neighborhood, the church part. It used to, I think they like half it with a police training building. It's all quite strange, but either way, he had a church there, and he's the pastor. He and another guy, Pastor Martin, but he told us a little bit about himself. He immigrated from Bhutan. It's in, like, is it the southern part of Asia? In between China and India. And he immigrated from Bhutan, and they went to Nepal. And not just him, but about 10,000 others, too. And they lived in a camp, a refugee camp, for 19 years. Wasn't it 19? Yeah, 19 years. I was sick all week, so I was a little groggy, so you'll have to excuse me if I keep checking my facts, but we'll get to that later. So we immigrate from Nepal, or from Bhutan to Nepal, and they're there for 19 years. He gets married there, he has his first kid there. Like, he's there for 19 years in a foreign country that he knows nothing about. But they left because the severe persecution in Bhutan for religion. You had to be Hindu, or you had to be Muslim, I believe. And what? Buddhist, not Muslim. I'm telling you, I'm sick, I'll wait, but we'll get there later. but anyways, he was telling us, you know, about how he first came to Christ. That's where all this, you know, takes form here. And he said that he was not a Christian at the time, and all of a sudden his mother gets sick. Not sick as in, like, physically sick, she gets mentally sick. People said that she was cursed and that she had sinned so bad that she was far from being helped, and that there's nothing you could do about it. No one was willing to help him. The dad, his father even leaves the family out of shame because of her, and she is she's mentally ill. So out of the 10,000 that immigrated, there are about 10 Christians. Only 10 out of 10,000. I don't know, I don't do math real well, so you can do the math there later. But these 10 people came, and they prayed for his mother. And she started getting better. After no one else could help her, they started getting better. So he said, while they were praying and she's getting better, he figured he'd start praying too. Well, she gets healed. All of the mental illness, all of her impalements and her ailments, they go away. And he said, you know, the one part that really stuck out to me was, he said that my mother was crazy and she was saved, and then I was crazy for God. I mean, come on. So I knew we was about to get into something good, you know, when that's the first thing he says to us. And I'm just like, all right, I'm ready to go. I was feeling better on this day, so this is the best feeling day I had all week, so I was ready to romp. So we split up into groups, and Pastor Martin takes a van and a few of us, and Pastor Beam takes a van and a few of us go somewhere different. And we go around this community. Well, the main objective here is to talk to these Nepali people in their homes, and if it gets around to it, we're going to talk about the gospel. I've never shared my faith before. I've never had to. I mean, come on, throw a penny and it hits a Baptist church here, or just a church in general. Not the case here at all. So most of the people that you see walking down the street don't even hardly speak English. So I'm out of my element, obviously. So I'm scared the whole time. I'm so nervous, and that because I don't want to say anything that is not true or is not going to help anybody. So I'm scared the whole time. But I was like, you know what? It's going to be all right. I'll figure it out later. You know, we'll get there. We'll cross that bridge when we come to it. Well, we go to about four houses, I believe, and it's not really houses. I think I say that a little loosely. They're apartments, and in one apartment, there was six people living in an apartment that was about that big, and there was probably three or four pieces of furniture, a nasty couch, two plastic broken chairs. I was really, really, really surprised that this was how bad it was. I mean, I've never met a refugee in my life. You know, there's not a refugee population here. If there is, I've never heard of it. But it is a strong presence there, especially where we went. And in that area, you know, we were driving down the road, and I asked Pastor Beam, I said, why is there not a strong, like, church presence out here? He says, people that are native to Syracuse are scared to come here. They're scared, he said. He put it gently. He said, a lot of naughty people live out here. So we're going to see the lowest of low, you could say. But then I thought about it. I was like, isn't that what Jesus did? Jesus didn't come to hang out, you know, with people who knew him already. He came to be with the people who didn't know him. So that was my whole take on it. Yeah, I was scared that we were in, you know, this neighborhood, but I was like, you know what, it's gonna be all right because Jesus did the same thing, so I'm gonna be okay too. And so we went to a Nepali home, and the last one before we met up with the group, and I got to talk to these girls, and we were talking, and one of the guys that was with us, he, God bless him, he pulled out probably the most confusing scripture he could to try to talk to one of these girls, God bless him, and I, you know that face some people get, that the engine's running but there's nobody behind the wheel kind of thing? Well, that's what they had going on. So I told him, you know, the part I love about Jesus is that he loved me when I didn't want to love me. And then they kind of, okay, I kind of get it now. So you relate it in a way, not, I mean, scripture is excellent, absolutely. But to people who have no idea, you relate it in a way that pertains to you. And that way, people understand. You can tell somebody that's something out of the Bible, and they'll kind of get it. But when you relate it on a personal level, that's when they really get it. Because then they know you're genuine about it and you're legit. Anybody can spout out verses and not know Christ. But someone who has known it and keeps it in their heart and then talks to them, they understand. And they want to know more. So I got to talk to them. And that was the first time I've ever shared my faith. And it was fantastic. Not on my part, because I know that nothing, none of that came from me. But it was good to feel like I reached out to somebody and they understood. So that was fantastic. But after we ate some lunch, we went and had worship with the Nepali people. And it was in an apartment that was yay big. And I counted 70 people. 70 people crammed, smashed together, but they did not care. From the old to the little kids, they were all there, and they were having the best time in the world. So we got to sing some songs in the Pali language. I say we, but I mean them, because we didn't obviously know what they're... yeah, it's kind of sideways. I don't know why it's sent that way, but huh? It's not at the beginning. Mm-hmm. That could have been awkward. Yeah. Okay. So we're going to do a little bit of improvising here. And you hear that? Can you hear that? Can you hear that? Thank you. If you want to see it again, you'll just have to holler at me later after the service. But the song is called Praise God, Hosanna to the King, is what they were singing. I didn't know really what they were saying, but I knew they were having a good time singing it because everybody and their mother was singing it, even the little kids who were probably about 5 knew all the words, and they were jamming. So I thought that was one of the coolest things I've ever seen, and I'm so glad that I got to experience that. We had supper with them. I didn't eat it because I'm not about the spicy life, so I'm just kind of I'm good. But it was like imagine that you take Rice Krispies and put seasoning in it. That's about the texture. So I was just kind of like, no, thank you. But it's called Moo Rye. Yeah, so I was thinking, they were handing it out, and I was just like, what's this? And they were like, Moo Rye. I was like, what does that mean? I don't know what that means. And I said, is it hot? They're like, no. So I was like, okay, I'll take a big spoonful. And I'm just like, oh my gosh, get it out. So apparently it is Nepali custom that the women like the Moo Rye very, very, very hot. And some of the first times that they serve it to people who have never had it, it gets really hot really quick. And they have to, like, the guys have to tell them you need to tone it down for people who are not used to it, because they like it on fire. So I was just kind of like, you know, I'm not about that, and I don't really like that. But, you know, one of the ladies was looking at me like, yeah, you like it? And I was like, it's great. It's great. As I was like slapping it on somebody, I think Alex's plate. But yeah, Moo Rye. Yeah, I don't really know what was in it, but I know it was really hot, so I didn't really like it. But there's a thing Pastor Beam told us that they say, and I want you to repeat. Okay, we're gonna break it down. J, Ma, C, J, Ma, C. That means praise God, and that's the way you greeted people. So.
Like this, you
say, Jamesy. And yes. And thank you is Danyabad. 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 And that is how you said thank you. So as soon as, I mean, we were just like kids in candy store with these two faces. We're like, Jamesy. And they're all like, okay, Jamesy, yeah, we got you. You know, but I thought it was like the coolest thing. And everybody I was meeting, I was like, Jamesy. They're like, okay. And then afterwards, we're all like, Danyabad, this is so great, Danyabad. And they're like, okay, thank you, you know. But yeah, that was my Thursday. So anybody else is going up next? You got it next? Okay. Go for it.
So, each and every one of us, all four, are going to tell you a brief idea of what our favorite part of the trip was. You want me to start off? Okay. So, for me, I'm used to a ministry that reaches out to people, large groups of people, and waits for them to plug in to that ministry and then begin to work with them, to begin to build those relationships. Brian had to sit me down because I was going around to people saying, hey, you know what the BCM is? Yeah, come up. I was just very enthusiastic, but what they do there is they build relationships first. They take time to invest and to get to know these people, not for the BCM, not to go to their particular church, but just to show love. And in that love, people begin to question. People of different denominations, different faiths, some not even faiths. There's some communists there from China. And it was a struggle for me because I was like, how in God's good name am I going to build a relationship with these people that I'm encountering on a bus going to class? Man, they want to go to class. They about ran me over. But the cool thing about their ministry that they've built, they might have a BCM that's a fourth the size of the one we have at JSU, but they have a connection with this campus, with both campuses, that is intermingled to where You can say, hey, you know this person? Yeah, I know that person. We hang out all the time. They have something called life groups, and this is my favorite part. It's where you go to experience life with one another. We call it Bible school or small groups or Bible study here. And what they would do is fellowship over a meal for an hour, go over scripture for about 15 minutes, and let the conversation go wherever God leads it. And it wasn't just secluded to believers. Once again, these people from all sorts of denominations, people that weren't even a part of the BCM, were a part of these life groups because it wasn't about any named organization, denomination, particular segregation. It was just love. And to get to see these people use something called discipling. If you have not read Matthew 28 and applied it to your own heart, I highly suggest it. I think most of y'all have. Don't get me wrong. But I really had to read it again and kind of look in my own heart and say, what is my concept of discipleship? And this trip helped me realize that I need to invest in others, not groups, not for any particular person to rescue them or save them, but just to love them. And I really enjoyed it, and I also got to eat some roadkill rabbit.
I had a lot of favorite parts, but I'll just share a couple. I got to hold an Apollyon baby that was like not even a month old. I loved that. I absolutely loved the worship. I've never felt that much joy in my life. I had tears running down my eyes. I was in that video. I don't know if you could see me or not, but I was crying and clapping. I don't know what they were saying, but it was just so genuine how they were worshiping. My other favorite part was being able to live with the college students. The two girls that I lived with were Shelby and Maggie, and they were really involved with the BCM there. And the biggest thing that they did was just try to build relationships, like Alex was saying. And they even built a relationship with me, and I was only there for a week. And they were able to help me through a lot of things that I've been struggling with, and just how they just took me in and loved me like I was going to be there forever. But really, I was just going to be there for a week, and I mean, I might not see them again. But they just took me in and loved me and encouraged me while I was there, and they were very thankful for what we were doing on their campus. So.
I guess mine was kind of reflective of the day that I talked about on Wednesday when we went to the Hope Print House. I kind of touched on it a second ago, but the kind of the scripture that they kind of live by is if you think back to Acts in chapter 17, it talks about how Paul goes to, I think it's in Athens somewhere. Anyway, he's kind of telling some people about who Jesus is and stuff like that. Just kind of, you know, here and there, people that he meets and are kind of friends with. And then one of the guys he meets, he's a part of a bigger group, of kind of a philosophical society. And they want him to come to the Areopagus. There we go. nerves got to me there. The Areopagus. And pretty much it's kind of like the round table for discussion of different faiths and stuff like that. And they wanted him to come and talk about Jesus. They had never heard about this. And so he got the chance to go and talk to them about who Jesus is. And that's kind of the mentality they take to these refugee people. They have this kind of community center where people come in and out of and learn learn English, hopefully get a job, but ultimately become their friend. And the really neat thing is, you know, so many times we see people as a project, you know, someone that we can try to help, which is good, obviously, but we see them more as a project, not necessarily a person. And they see all these people, as friends. I mean, these are legitimate friends to these refugees. And so much so that eventually they get to the point where they can share their faith. They can tell them about who Jesus is. And that's really, really neat, because a lot of times we just see so many people as a project instead of a person. So That's something that's really challenged me. So thank y'all so much for everything y'all do.
Mine was a little hard to think. What's the most meaningful thing out of the week? As I touched on just briefly a second ago, I was sick. Pretty much the day or the night we stepped off the bus, I started getting sick. Sunday, I was sick as a dog. I didn't even get out of bed. So the whole week was a struggle, to say the least. And I was just like, you know, what was the whole point of me coming up here if I was going to be sick the whole time? And I really didn't understand it. I was like, God, really? You're going to do this to me now? You know, like, the time that I feel like I'm supposed to be doing something, I can't because I'm hoarse and I'm sick and I'm sneezing and nobody wants to be around somebody like that. So I was really struggling that whole week. And Thursday was just that, like, kick in the face that I needed, you know. I'm hard-headed, so, you know, God don't just get my attention by saying, Michelle, this is what you need to do. He's got to, like, hit me in the face with it. And I'm like, okay, now I get it. So the most meaningful thing for me was the worship. You know, these people had nothing, not a thing, yet they were so excited to be there. And they kept filing in the door. And I was thinking, how much more room we got, you know? Like, we didn't. I was slammed on a couch with this lady. And I said, so how long you been in the United States? She said, no English. I was like, okay, all right, never mind. So, you know, I was just kind of like, all right, you know, we're all in here. And but these people hungered for God. And I have never seen that. I have never seen that genuine, you know, laying it all out there, nothing to lose, faith in God. I've never seen it. And I've never seen people who were so, like, this is the highlight of their week. Like, this was it. This was, you know, not only did they get to fellowship with their fellow Nepali people, but they got to hear the word. And as soon as Pastor Beam took out his Bible, everybody ripped out their Bible and they were just flipping through and they knew exactly where he was talking about. They didn't do the, you know, everybody kind of does, I really don't remember where this part is. I look to the front. Of course I know where that is. Yeah. No, these people knew it, and they knew their Bible, and they knew exactly what they were doing, and they knew who Jesus was. And, you know, I could feel the Spirit moving in that place more than I have in a really, really, really long time. And it didn't matter that they weren't of the same ethnicity as me. They were my brothers and sisters, and I felt that, and I knew that. And I knew that this was something that it was meant to happen. And had I just been, you know, called mom and dad and be like, I want you to take me home. I want you to come get me and take me home because I'm tired of being here. And I think I said that. I think I said that Tuesday night. I said, I'm tired of being here because I'm sick and nothing has gone right. And I thought, If I had gone home, I would have missed one of the largest blessings I have ever received in my life. So, you know, that was me trying to fix everything. And God been like, if you'll just calm down for a minute, I'm going to make it okay. And that was, I had to learn what trust really is. And when they did prayer, that was one of the other meaningful things. You know, they did everybody speaking out loud. You know, we're Baptists. We don't do that. You know, everybody, we're going to. You can say it up here, but don't be saying it out loud now. And when they started, I was just like, oh my, everybody. But it didn't matter if they were 95 or 5, they were saying their own prayer. I've never seen children pray that earnestly before in my life. I've never seen it. And they knew who they were praying to. They didn't do it because mom and daddy said that's who they needed to pray to. They did it because they knew who their Savior was. And one of my favorite movies, Fried Green Tomatoes, you know, it says, you know, I think there's a separate God for children. And I think these little children knew who that God was, and they went to the throne when they prayed. So that was, you know, it got to show me, you know, that, you know, if you're not hungry for the word every time you come into a place of worship, then you need to reflect on why you're here. You know, why are you here? What is it that you think you're going to get out of this if you are not starving every time you walk in that door? And that stepped all over my toes. It stepped all on them. And I couldn't answer that question. I couldn't say, why am I here? And I was so upset all week because of it. And then that answered my question. I need to be hungry. Every time I come in that door, I need to be hungry and I need to be starving. And I was starving that week. I was starving because nothing went my way. But you know what? When you hit rock bottom, you got nowhere but up. And I knew I was at the end of my rope, but I tied a knot, and God shoved me. This is what you needed to learn. So, you know, just these people love the Lord, and that's all they had. And by seeing them praise the Lord, you wouldn't know that they didn't have anything. You thought they had it all. And I was thinking, you know, that's something that I don't think we understand, you know. They knew what was important in life, and it wasn't material things. You know, I think sometimes we can get it a little sideways as about who's wearing the nicest clothes, who's got the nicest stuff, who's driving the nicest car. And those people, they're all on the same level, and they didn't care because they knew who they were praying to, and they knew who was going to save them, and they wanted it more than anybody I've ever seen in my life. So thank you. Thank you for giving me that blessing. Thank you for sending me, and thank you for helping me realize that how hungry I need to be. And I hope that you're the same way, that you leave here, and that you starve. I hope you do. I hope you starve for the Word. And I hope every time that you come in here, you realize how hungry you are and what that means. So I'm going to close us in prayer, and then I guess we will be dismissed. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just thank you. Lord, you are so good. You're so good, and we can do nothing for you like you've done for us. But you did it anyways, and I thank you so much for that, Father. I know we're not hungry like we should be. And sometimes we get a little sideways about what it means to be hungry, and we don't understand sometimes. But, Lord, I just want you to put that hunger in our heart, and I want you to make us on fire. On fire every time we walk in these doors, and on fire every time that we praise your name. Lord, I just ask that you just put that in us, and you make us want that every day, that we wake up and we praise your name. So thank you, Lord, for this amazing, amazing church family who has sent me and my friends to Syracuse to do your work. And Lord, we wouldn't have gone without them, and I hope and I pray that they can feel how grateful that we are and how special that they are to us. And I thank you, Lord, for putting them in our lives because I know how big of a blessing that they are. So I just thank you once again, Lord, for everything that you do, and let us be able to see the fruits of our labor in Syracuse at a later date. And we thank you once again, Father, for what you mean for us and what you've done for us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
We're done.